Hello, I'm Reverend Sam, and I'm your host on The Secret of Glory and Power. Today, I want us to start a series on the richest man in Babylon. Now, this book was written in 1926. This book contained the story, real life story of men who came from poverty and they became rich. It's been a book that is so dear to my heart because I read this book like, I think about 10 or 11 years ago. After I read the book, because of the impact that the book had in my life, I developed a teaching series for our Sunday school in our church, and we taught it for 2.5 years. Every Sunday we kept on teaching one principle after the other that I got from the book. And though some people don't make use of what we got from there, but a few of those who make use of it, today their life is far better. And I feel, and of course, the thing had a lot of impact on my own life. So it's been my dream on how to make sure I share this secret to more people. So I believe that from today, I'm going to begin to share with you secret after secret that have been used as far back as almost 6,000 years ago. Now, you know, let's try to look at the background of the country we're talking about. We talked about the story of people that lived in Babylon. Babylon is no more today. In fact, the time we are talking about was about 6,000 years ago. And Babylon was not a country that had a lot of natural resources. They don't have water every time, so they had to use a lot of mechanized farming system. Even far back then, that country is more or less like the Western world. You have a combination of the extremely rich and the extremely poor, and all of them stay in the same country. But then, the first story that I want to share with you is the story of three friends. They started their life together, but one of them decided early in his life that he wanted to know how to be rich because he was born in poverty and he loved the good things of life, and he wanted to make sure that as he grows older, he's able to enjoy those things that he sees other people enjoy. So as a youth, he started employing himself to knowing how to make money and how to keep money and how to keep making money. However, the other two friends, they just lived their life. They learned a trade. One was a musician, the other one was a horse, you know, the seat on the horse. He was the kafa. He makes those seats. And one day, the two of them sat down and they began to think, and they began to say to themselves, they have wives and they have children. They didn't have enough money to take care of their wives. Their wives are just, you know, using bed down select, secondhand clothes, and they barely feed their family. And they began to think, and they began to say to themselves, when they look, they saw gigantic stories. They saw architectural edifices that the rich built around them, and yet they were poor. But what was most striking to the two of them was that their third friend is renowned as the richest man in Babylon. And they said to themselves, but we started life together. All of us started as young people. We kept on running up and down. What did this man know that we don't know? In fact, the man that is accounted as richest man in Babylon, his name is called Akkad. The other two friends who were struggling, one is Banzil. Banzil is the horseback maker. And then Kobi is the musician. I want to please follow me up in this story. If your desire is to understand the secret of how to make money, please follow me up. One of the things I've come to discover about us in this part, in Africa especially, is that we are not patient to have a long-term plan. And that's why many a time, some of us who have planned, if plan does not work out because we did not give it enough time. It's like a woman that is pregnant and wanted to see her baby by the fifth month. We almost abort the plans that we have. But let me, I'm going to read the books. I'm going to try and make some explanations because I feel that that's the best way you'll be able to understand. Now, one of the friends, Kobe, was speaking to Aka. He said this very day, suggested Kobe, I passed by our old friend, Aka, riding in his golden chariot. This, I will say, he did not look over my humble head, as many in the station might consider his right. Instead, he did wave his hand at all onlookers, so that they might see and pay him greetings and bestow his smile of friendship upon Kobe the musician. And then, Banzi said, you know what? I just wish that I would just meet him somewhere in the bush. I would just take the money that he has. And then Kobe said, you are foolish. The secret of a man's wealth is real money. It's not the gold he has in his purse. It's the wisdom he has to make money and to keep making money. So one of them decided. Kobe said, you know, me, I think that he did teach his knowledge to his son, Nomazu. Kobe responded, did we not go to Nineveh and so it is told that in an inn, we wish to become men of means. And then one of them said, What you just said, give me an inspiration, Basil. You bring to my mind a new understanding. You make me to realize the reason why we have never found any measure of wealth. We never sought for it. You did labor patiently to build strongest chariots in Babylon. To that purpose was devoted the best of your strength. Therefore, as it thou did succeed, have you succeeded? I strove to become a skillful lyre, a lyre player, like a musician. And at that one too, I have succeeded. In those things towards which we exerted our best endeavor, we succeeded. The gods were satisfied to let us continue this way. Now at last, we see a light. Bright light that is from the rising sun. It bidded us to learn more that we may prosper more. With a new understanding, we shall find honorable ways to accomplish our desires. Let us go to Aka this very day, Bazin urged. Also, let us ask other friends of our days that who have feared no better than ourselves, every one of them that are poor and they are all friends. They said, let us all go to Bazin. Let us go to Aka. Let us ask him to teach us the secret of how to make money. And when they went to Akkad, I'm going to like paraphrase because of time. When they went to Akkad, look at what Akkad said. And there were certain friends of younger days who came to him and said, you Akkad, you are more fortunate than we. You have become the richest man in all Babylon while we struggle for existence. You can wear the finest clothes and you can enjoy the rarest food while we must be satisfied if we can clothe our families with ordinary clothes and presentable food for them to eat. Look at what Akka said. Yes, once all of us are equal, you see, we studied under the same master, we played in the same games, and in neither of the studies nor the game did we outshine us. And in the years since, you have been no more an honorable citizen than we. They were telling him that, listen, when all of us were younger, we played together, we grew together, each of us learned a trade, and we went to go and start doing what we are doing. So when we look at our background, you are not better than us. So what is the secret? How did you become rich? That was the question they asked him. Now, let me go straight because we don't have much time. Now, as for study, did not our wise teacher teach us that learning was of two kinds? The one kind being the kind we learn and knew, and the other being the training that taught us how to find out what we did not know. I found employment as a scribe, that is Aka talking now. I found employment as a scribe in the Hall of Records. And long hours each day, I labored upon the clay tablets, week after week, month after month. I labored, yet for my earnings, I have nothing to show, only food and clothing and penance to the gods, and other things of which I could remember not. Absorbed all my earnings, but my determination did not leave me. The greatest thing, the first thing that anyone that will succeed in life will have, is an undying desire to succeed. The truth is, it's your desire that will push you forward. Even when everything seems gloomy, even when there seems to be no way, you keep pushing because you have desire. That's what the guy said. The guy said, so I labored hard. But the law was, okay, now one day, Algamish, the money lender, came to the house of the city master and ordered a copy of the ninth law. And he said to me, I must have this in 2 days. And if the task is done by that time, 2 coppers will I give thee. So I labored hard, but the law was long. And when Algamish returned, the task was unfinished. He was angry. And had I been a slave, he would have beaten me. But knowing the city master would not permit him to injure me, I was unafraid. So I said to him, Algamish, you are a very rich man. Tell me how I may also become rich. And all night I will carve upon the clay, and when the sun rises, it shall be complete. The guy saw an opportunity. Now, he smiled and replied, You are a forward man, but we will call it a bargain. All that night I carved, though my back pained, and the smell of the wick made my head ache, until my eyes could hardly see. But when he returned at sun up, the tablets were complete. Now, I said, tell me what you promise. You have fulfilled your part of the bargain, my son. That's what Algamish said. He said to me kindly, and I'm ready to fulfill mine. I will tell you these things you wish to know, because I am becoming an old man, and an old man loves to work. And when youth come to age for advice, he receives the wisdom of years. But too often does youth think that ages know only the wisdom of the days that are gone, and therefore profit not. But remember this, the sun that shines today is the sun that shone when your father was born, and will still be shining when your last grandchild shall pass into darkness. What is the guy saying? The guy is saying, listen, you have done what I said. I will teach you the secret to be rich. He said, but you know what? Do you think that the wisdom of the aged is relevant to their own age? He said, but let me tell you something. The same sun that shined on your grandfather, the same sun that is shining on you right now, and when your great-grandchildren are going to be born and they will die, the same sun will still be shining. In other words, what he's saying is that the wisdom to succeed is the same. The dispensation may differ, but the principles are the same. Let's go ahead. Now, mark you my words very well. For if you do not, you will fail to grasp the truth that I will tell you, and you will think that your night work has been in vain. Then he looked at me curiously from under a shaggy brow, and he said in a low, forceful tone, I found the road to wealth when I decided that a part of all I earn was mine to keep, and so will you. Let me explain what he meant by that. He said he found the road to wealth when he decided and discovered that out of every salary he makes, out of every money he collects, a part of that money should belong to him. And then he continued to look at me with a glance that I could feel pierce me, but said no more. Is that all I asked? That was sufficient to change the heart of a sheep herder into the heart of a money lender, the man replied. But all I earn was mine to keep, is it not? The young man demanded. Far from it, he replied. Do you not pay the garment maker when I buy this suit? I give part of the money I earn to the suit maker. Do you not pay the sandal maker? Do you not pay for the things you eat? Can you live in Babylon without spending? What have you to show for your earning of the past month?
For what the past years, oh you fool, you pay to everyone but yourself. That means when I earn salary, I pay light, I pay my phone, I pay internet, I buy clothes, I make groceries, I give tithes, and I, you know, and the man is saying, but you give every other person money for the services they are rendering to you. The coat maker, give me coat, I give you money. PowerPoint, give me light, I give them money. He said, but you discover that every month you collect money and you give it to other people. You are not giving yourself anything. That's what the man said to him. And then he now said to him, my knowledge of the number did not forsake me. And I answered. Now the man now asked him, if you save 1/10, 10% of what you are earning every month, at the end of 1 year, how much are you going to, at the end of 10 years, how much are you going to have? So the young man, Akkad, he calculated and said, I'm going to have 1 year income. Now look at what the man said. My knowledge of number did not forsake me, and answered him, as much as I earn in 1 year, you speak but have the truth, he retorted. Every gold piece you save is a slave to work for you. Every money you save is meant to work for you. Every copper that it earned is his child that also can earn for you. If you will become wealthy, then what you save must earn, and his children must also earn, that all may help to give you the abundance that you desire. You think I cheat you for your long night's work, he continued, but I'm paying you 1,000 times over if you have the intelligence to grasp the truth I just gave you. A part of all you earn is yours to keep. It should be no less than 1/10, no matter how little you are earning. It can be more, as you can afford. Pay yourself first. Do not buy from the cloth seller and the sandal maker more than you can pay out of the rest, and still have enough for food and charity and giving to God. Wealth, like a tree, grow from a tiny seed. The first money you save is the seed from which your tree of wealth shall grow. The sooner you plant that seed, the sooner shall the tree grow, and the more faithfully you nourish and water that tree with consistent savings, sooner may you bask in abundance and contentment under his shade. What did that man say? That man says, save at least 10% of your income. And that money you save, don't just keep it in the bank. Look for something that you can invest the money into, so that the money that you have saved can also make you profit. And then the profit that the money you save can join the money you save and make you further profit. The secret of the rich. This guy, I've forgotten his name now. This guy is a stock person. He said the secret of making money are three. Make money. Let the money you have made also make money for you. And number three, repeat the process over and over and over again. Now, Warren Buffett, that's what he said. Now, but this one is dated 1926. Warren Buffett is still alive. That is to let you know that the secret of wealth is the same. Ages might differ, dispersion might differ, but if you understand the secret and put them to use, it will work for you. If I can finish this particular first one, then we continue later. Now, a 12 months after, Algamish had gone, he again returned and said to me, son, have you paid to yourself not less than 1/10 of all you have earned in the past 1 year? I answered proudly, yes, master, I have. That is good, he answered, beaming upon me. And what have you done with it? I have given it to Amzo, the bricklayer, who told me he was traveling over to a far sea in Tyre. He will buy for me a rare jewel of the Phoenicians. When he returns, we shall sell this at high price and divide the earning. Then that old man said, Every fool must learn, he growled. But why do you trust the knowledge of a bread maker concerning jewels? Will you go to the bread maker to inquire about the stars? No, by my tonic. Will you go to the astrologer if you had power to think? Your savings are gone. Youth, you have jacked your wealth tree by the root, but plant another. Try again, and next time, if you will have advice about jewels, go to jewel merchant. If you will know the truth about sheep, go to herdsmen. Advice is one thing that is freely given away, but watch that you take only what is worth having. He who takes advice about his savings from one who is inexperienced in such matter shall pay with his savings for proving the falsity of the opinion. Saying this, he went away. What does that mean? The man said, listen, you gave your money to a bricklayer to go help you buy gold. He said it's foolish. He said, the man, you have given the money you saved for 1 year to help you buy gold from another country, so that when they bring it back, you guys can sell. He said, no, you are going to lose that money. Because the man is a bricklayer. The man is not experienced in gold. If you want to give your money to buy gold, go to someone that is dwelling in gold. If you want to invest in sheep, go to a sheep shearer. In other words, a shepherd. If you want to invest your money in different kinds of wood, go to a carpenter. Don't give your money to someone who's not experienced in a particular area and you expect them to help you invest your money. He said, son, your money is lost, but start all over again. And look at what happened. And it was as he said, for the Phoenicians are scoundrels and sold to Amza worthless bits of glass that look like gems. But as Agamish had said, I again save each tenth copper. For now, I have formed the habit and it was no longer difficult. 12 months after, Agamish came to the room of the scribe and addressed me. What progress have you made since I last saw you? I have paid myself faithfully, I replied, and my savings I have entrusted to Aga, the shield maker, to buy bronze. And each fourth month, every three months, he does pay me renter. That is good. And what do you do with renter? Oh, I do have a great feast with honey and fine wine and spiced cake. Also, I have bought me a scarlet tonic. And someday, I will buy me a young ass, just like you buy me a new car, upon which to ride. To which Agamish laughed. You do eat the children of your savings. Then, how do you expect them to work for you? How can they have children that will also work for you? First, get thee an army of golden slaves, and then many a rich banquet may you enjoy without regret. Saying this, he went away. What does he mean by that? You know, this guy learned over another 1 year to save money. He gave the money to the right guy who did business in the right business, and the guy is giving him interest every 4 months. And then Agami said, okay, so the interest that the man give you, which is like the children that your money has born, what did you do with them? He said, I started enjoying life. I gave my wife money to cook me good soup. I change my clothes. I buy a new car so that I can start enjoying life. Agami shake his head and then laugh. He said, you have just killed the children of your money. What's supposed to happen is, the profit you make from your money should be invested again to make more profit for you. Then the profit that the profit make, you invest again to make profit for you. He said, by the time you have now started having a lot of income, then you can start enjoying. You don't kill the future of your wealth because you started making money. And when the guy said that, he left and he went away. This is a story of people who have lived in time past. This story meant a lot to me because it changed my orientation. It helped me to become a better businessman.
He tell me to become a more knowledgeable financial counselor. As a matter of fact, to tell you the truth, when I read this thing, after like 2.5 years of teaching it, I started a microfinance business. Now, I'm telling you these things because I want you to know that before this man could get that wisdom correctly, it took him 2 years. So what I'm telling you right now, the light I am giving you, the wisdom I'm sharing with you, is not something that is going to make you buy a new car by December. It's not the kind of wisdom that you're going to begin to apply and in 8 months you are basking in great wealth. No. Money is like tiny drops of rain. When rain is falling, you see tiny, tiny drops. But when you put a bowl outside, with time, the tiny drop begins to form water, and then it becomes more and more and more. And another way to explain it is that money is like a seed that must be planted. It has its gestation period. It has the period when the seed is going to die. Then the seed will now begin to sprout and then begin to bring forth more harvest. Considering your age right now, maybe if you are older and you are watching me right now, you say, I've wasted life. No. You can start planting the seed of prosperity that you will now teach your children to follow after. And before you die, you can still enjoy. It takes time. But if you make up your mind, it will all come to pass. I'm going to continue on this story the next time we meet. But I want you to know that you can help us to reach more people by bringing your advert to this program. You can support this program. You can be sending us, support so that we can be having more opportunity to do this. Because I believe that especially people that are children of God, that is my passion. I want the people of God to prosper. The Bible says the Lord God has given us power to get wealth. So why are many, majority of the people in the house of God, why are we struggling financially? It's because we know the spiritual principle, we are paying our tithe. But the truth is we don't know the practical principles that can help us to amass wealth over a period of time. I want you to tell your friend about this program. Tell them to keep watching. Because as we gain wisdom more and more through the experience of those who have gone through before us, we will definitely have a better testimony tomorrow. Don't forget what I'm going to say now. The wisdom to success is the same. But someone who have not succeeded can never teach you how to succeed. I'm reading the story of those who came from poverty to riches. You can learn from them so that your life can get better. I'm going to see you next time. Until I see you again, I'm Reverend Sam Ajibade. I'm your host on The Secret of Glory and Power. God bless you. Bye-bye.